This episode of Artist Decoded is brought to you by No Wave Academy. Whether you're a beginner or a seasoned professional, No Wave Academy is your ultimate educational resource to help bring your artistry to the next level. Our renowned roster of instructors include Nick Runge, Mia Bergeron, Sean Cheatham, Kate Zambrano, David Chaffetz, Paul Christina, John Wentz, and many more. Some of these artists have appeared on this very podcast, while others have been featured in exhibitions at the No Wave Gallery and museums around the world. Here at No Wave Academy, we believe that everyone has a unique artistic expression. With guidance, experience, and the proper tools, students have the ability to invigorate and elevate their work. Unlock and unblock your inner creative voice. Join us and walk into the next chapter of your personal artistic evolution. Go to nowaveacademy.com. Type in AD-10 at checkout for 10% off. That's NOHWaveAcademy.com. Now, onto the episode. Hey, everybody. This is your host, Yoshino. You're listening to episode number 207 of Artist Decoded. In this episode, my friend and co-host, Justin Dosher Hopkins, interviews Stuart Biddlecombe, who is the cinematographer for the very popular Hulu show, The Handmaid's Tale. In this episode, he talks about working alongside Elizabeth Moss, both as an actor and as the director and executive producer of the show. Stuart talks about his work on season 3 and season 4 of The Handmaid's Tale. He also talks about his experiences working on other TV shows, including Call the Midwife and Doctor Who. So before we begin this episode, we recently started a YouTube page. You should go there and like and subscribe whenever you have the chance. We've been providing a lot of new additional content there, including full episodes and video clips. Also, when you can, please go to our iTunes page and leave us a review. The more the merrier, and it helps for viewers such as yourself to hear about Artist Decoded. Okay, so here it is. Without further ado, Artist Decoded, episode number 207 with cinematographer Stuart Biddlecombe. Hope you enjoy it.
Hello, everyone. We are joined today by cinematographer and director of photography, Stuart Biddlecombe. Did I say that right?
You did. Yeah, that was okay, very good. Well done.
Thank you. And he was kind enough to join us right after finishing up with work, which is, I imagine, a pretty exhausting day. Did you have a full day today?
Yeah, we did. Yeah. It was an early start. We were trying to catch the sun at a certain point in the sky. But in typical fashion, it wasn't sunny, it was cloudy. So it was kind of a bit of a waste of time. But it wasn't a waste of time, but you know, we got up very early and the sun was behind clouds and you know, it's not as good as we had hoped. But no, never mind. Yeah, you know, it's all good. So but yeah, a long day.
I mean, that's part of the challenge of your occupation, I guess, is just dealing with whatever you gotta adapt to on any given set.
Oh my God. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You just kind of have to kind of roll with the punches, really, particularly in the UK, I think, you know, because the weather is kind of so kind of up and down. You just got to, you know, you plan, you kind of hope that, you know, a certain weather conditions is going to come your way, but 9 times out of 10, it doesn't. So you just end up kind of, doing your best you can to try and make it work. You know, we always do. And, you know, we have the gear to make it work, but it's always the way. You know, you kind of want it sunshine, and it never is. It's pouring rain all the opposite way around. But
sure,
you know, you just kind of, you know, we make it work in one way or another.
Of course. And is this the new seasons of Handmaid's Tale?
Yeah, no, this isn't the new season of Handmaid's Tale. This is a new show which I'm doing for Amazon. We finished Handmaid's Tale. We finished it in March, and this is a new job I'm on. Shooting here in the UK. Hopefully we'll be coming back to Handmaid's Tale season 5 next year. hopefully. Yeah, hopefully. Fingers crossed.
I mean,
but yeah, hopefully.
Yeah, of course. I mean, how has it been working in, under the pandemic?
You know what? It's been okay, actually. I feel very lucky to be working full stop, in all honesty. You know, there's a lot of people in our industry who aren't working. So I feel very lucky to be working. And it's been okay. You know, we were on Handmaid's Tale, we were one of the first people to head back after the pandemic. And my hat's off to MGM and Hulu and everyone, Company 3, and everyone, the producers of Handmaid's Tale. We kind of got things up and running pretty quickly. So that's fine. And, you know, we wore masks. We did some social distancing. We had testing. We couldn't shoot certain scenes because of, you know, we could only have maybe kind of 10, 15 people on a set or kind of on in front of camera at one time. So kind of we had a load of big crowd scenes written for us, but we couldn't shoot them. They had to have them rewritten into kind of smaller, more intimate scenes, which I don't mind. You know, I kind of like these more intimate scenes. So it's fine. So yeah, we were very lucky that we were, you know, we kind of got up and running pretty quickly. So yeah, in all honesty, it didn't really affect us that much. Apart from that, you know, everyone stood down for a few months, back at the peak of it. But yeah, it was, we were very, you know, as I said, we were very lucky just to keep going. Yeah, and it didn't affect us that much actually.
I mean, that's just another instance of you having to adapt to the situation no matter what it is. It's a shame about the crowd scenes actually, because I made a note that I especially love some of your crowd scenes in Handmaid's Tale in particular, like a lot of those beautiful wide vistas with all the, you know, the uniforms and the beautiful set design and everything. It's really amazing how you're able to make everything look so painterly with so many moving parts and stuff. So I just wanted to give you a little bit of a compliment on that front, because that's not always the easiest thing to do. Or I find that everything feels like there's some sort of metaphor backed by the story with the overhead crowd scenes that I've seen a lot in The Handmaid's Tale, which they almost look like cells moving around. I'm kind of going to run this podcast in a more of an organic way.
We will get back to your beginnings,
but I want to start just by asking you how you sort of like develop that sort of language. Is it you working with the director, or do you come up with these ideas that you see in your head, or the influences from art or paintings or other films?
We are blessed with extraordinary scripts on Handmaid's Tale, and our producers and our writers give us for absolute reign. We can do pretty much wherever we like. So we are very lucky in that respect, really. And kind of our references, they come from all sorts. You know, I was very lucky to be able to work with Elizabeth Moss as her DAP on a few episodes. And our creative process was, I don't think it's particularly unusual in what we did, but we didn't necessarily think, okay, we're going to shoot this like a very typical Handmaid's Tale episode. You know, we're going to get references from season one, season two, or whatever. We kind of got our references from all sorts, from music, from pieces of artwork, from music videos, from anything which kind of caught our eye during our pre-production process. So we just used to, it was during COVID time. So at the time I was in the UK and she was in, you know, somewhere in the US. And we were just kind of sending messages together, and we just used to send messages, go, listen to this piece of music. You know, we used to spend, you know, Spotify or Apple Music, whatever. We used to send each other playlists. And it wasn't just Elizabeth Moss, it was all sorts of all the other directors as well. But kind of that was our inspiration. You go, okay, this scene, this is what we're after. This is kind of what the sense, what we want from those scenes. I think from a piece of music, it's much more easy, I think, to understand of what kind of emotions you're kind of portraying a scene than saying, okay, I want this, that, and the other, you know, and trying to put it into words. But I think with a piece of music, I think you can very quickly latch onto what you're trying to tell in a particular scene. So our inspiration was from everywhere. You know, one of our inspirations was a Radiohead music video, and there was just one shot. There's just one shot where so one of the characters in the music video rises up and back of head and they turn slow motion. And that clicked with us. Okay, that's what we want. So our inspiration came from all sorts of areas. And it was exciting. I can kind of, you know, I think we're very lucky in what we do is that we take inspiration from all sorts, from architecture, from, you know, from short films, from all sorts, really. And I think that's kind of the best way, I think.
Hmm. So it's interesting about the music component, because that's like one of the more abstract pieces of art to interpret into image, I feel like. Is that kind of what makes it more interesting to use as a reference, because you're just distilling it down to the kind of emotive qualities of it?
I think that's exactly what it is. Yeah. I think, as I said, it's, you can latch onto a piece of music very quickly. And it's almost like a shortcut, I think, for it. But I think you're right. No, music, for me at least, and I'm sure I'm not alone, I think it's for many people, can very quickly evoke emotions from, you know, you could be the most happiest person alive to bursting out in tears on just a simple key change or whatever. You know, it's I'm not a musician, but I think I can appreciate music. I think I can. I hope I can. And it's a very good tool for us, I think. As I said, just so that you can immediately know exactly what kind of feel you're after. It's a great tool, and I think it's, and I think in our film industry, we it isn't just visual, you know, it is all sorts. It's about the feeling inside you. And I think that's what music certainly evokes. It's what you feel in your heart, really, without sounding, you know, perhaps a bit too arty, I suppose. But it is, you know, it is very much, you know, I try to, in the shows I work on, I try to put a bit of myself on screen. And by using music and by different types of inspirations, I think I can do that. And music, it's kind of a shortcut for me to do that. But it's important, you know, you have to put yourself on screen. You have to be authentic. Otherwise, I think the audiences kind of see through it, I think.
Absolutely. Well, you mentioned a little bit of the Radiohead as a reference, but I think that was more for the shot in the music video. But like, give us a little bit of an insight. What are these pieces of music as an example that you are reinterpreting onto the screen?
Lizzie's a big fan of Max Richter, and so am I. Oh, I mean, I think anything, Neil Thrum as well. Any kind of those type of music, my playlists are pretty melancholic. I think whenever I sit in the car and my wife is sitting in the car, she just goes, Jesus Christ, is this all you listen to? Do you not listen to any other kind of upbeat music? But for me, it's a really good way of reaching a certain state of mind. I think when I was on Handmaid's Tale, I used to dive deep into this music so that I could really, it kind of evoked ideas very quickly in me. And it visual ideas, you know, I have a beer and, you know, I listen to this music on the headphones, and all of a sudden the emotions arise and ideas start to pop in. So it's a very good tool, but it is all sorts. You know, it isn't just those kind of those melancholic, you know, sounds. It's also, you know, it is Radiohead. It is, what is it? You know, it's Bear's Den. It's all sorts. It's all sorts of music which kind of appeals to me and which I can then kind of springboard from. Classical music. I mean, all sorts. I mean, anything really. You know, I think we're very lucky nowadays that we have Spotify and all those type of things, that we can just very quickly just dip in and find something which is very emotive and very kind of unique for that certain scene.
Absolutely. I think that's, I mean, it makes sense that you're talking about Max Richter and those kinds of music, because when I was watching The Handmaid's Tale with my wife, it felt like it would be in that Arvo Pärt kind of world, the spiritual and secular kind of, but really, you know, vast sort of sonic quality. And the dynamics of the show have that. It's interesting that you say that. Now I can kind of see that in there when I'm looking back and thinking about the shots. There is musicality to it. And it's hard to know how much of that sometimes is the director of photography, how much of that is the actors just moving and, you reacting or the director, whatever. It's very interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a mixture, really. I don't know whether Handmaid's Tale is unique, but the creative input, which I have the cinematographer on this show, is out of this world. So I think that it is a mixture. It is it is me, it is the director, and it is the writers, of course. But it's across the board. My gaffer, I couldn't do this show without my gaffer. I couldn't do this show without my operators. I couldn't do any of this show with the entire crew because they do give us such creative input. So it isn't just me. I hold my hand up and, when you see a beautiful shot on Handmaid's Tale or any other show, there's a huge amount of people behind it, as I'm sure your listeners understand. But It is, but the Handmaid's Tale in particular, it is very much a collaborative TV show, particularly in the creative departments. I think I could go on for hours about this, but the art department, our designers, extraordinary, and we work as a whole to create these images, and you look back on it when I'm sitting in the grade and I'm watching this back, it's very difficult for me to pinpoint whose idea these certain elements are, because they are from all of us. So it is very much a group. It is very much an idea which springs, which can kind of just come from the tiniest thing, like a piece of music or like a piece of artwork, and then just blooms. It blooms from all of us, we all kind of input it into something which I hope is visually interesting and kind of takes our audience in. It's impossible to tell you whose idea they are, because I think they are all of us.
Absolutely. And I think a lot of people listening will understand that you guys are a part of this big collective brain. But I think also a lot of listeners are more used to the idea of crews working on movies, and you have this project and then the movie's done and then that's that you had one singular vision that you're going through this film and it's one crew. Whereas a TV show, you have to bring in different personnel, other people are in contract with other things, so sometimes you have to switch out crew and creatives and things like that. What is it like working in a TV show where you have to have continuity but also put your own creative spin on it? And how do you function within that world versus let's say a film or something like that?
I think kind of it is my job. It isn't my only, I'm not the only person in charge of this, but it is also the designer as well, Elizabeth Williams. We are the continuity. I was on it from day one until long before production finished, when I was sitting in the grade only a few weeks ago. So it's kind of our role to gently steer where this enormous ship goes. I am there to serve the director. It is their vision. And if they choose to shoot a scene in a particular way, I can say, perhaps we can do this, perhaps we can do that. But ultimately it is their decision. So I can gently steer people. But it's not my, I am the DOP, I'm not the director. So ultimately, I have a vision, but if the director wants it to go another way, then that's their prerogative. As I said, it's part of my job. I'm there to serve, to a lesser or greater extent, the vision of the director. There is a greater vision, from the writers and the executive producers, which, I am well aware of. But we are... I'm there, they are the master, and I am the captain. I kind of gently push them in certain directions, but ultimately,
right.
I don't have the final say.
do you consider yourself, or what you do in the cinematography world, do you consider yourself more of an artist or a craftsman, if you even distinguish the two?
That's a good question. I don't know. I'm not sure if I distinguish the two, really. I like to think I'm more of a... I guess craftsman means that you have... an idea of the technicalities of it, I guess. And for me, cinematography isn't really about the technicalities of it. I think kind of when I first started out, when I knew I wanted to be a cinematographer, I was kind of very, very aware that I needed to know the technicalities of being a cinematographer. I needed to know about film stocks, needed to about cameras, about grip equipment, and how to mount, you know, cameras on various different bits of equipment. But I quickly realized that that's not important. What's important is telling a story through camera movement, through lighting, through composition. And so my ideas changed, I think, and I learned that, and I got that at film school. But one of my amazing tutors, Brian Tofano, he very quickly said to me, Stuart, this isn't our business. We have to understand a little bit of the technicalities of our role, but it isn't about that. Our primary role is to tell a story, and we have other people to look after cameras and lighting. We have gaffers, we have focus pullers, we have all this, that, and the other. They're the ones who look after the technicalities of it. But what our job is to tell that story through our toolbox. So to answer your question, I guess I'm probably more of an artist, I think, without sounding awful. I think I'm probably an artist rather than a craftsman, I think.
I think that's great. I mean, there is something interesting and unique about your work when I've went back and reviewed it and looked at your resume, and I've watched several of the shows that you've worked on. Like my wife and I really like Called a Midwife a lot, and we watched the Sherlock the Sherlock show and all their specials. Yeah. And it looks there's a certain kind of painterly quality to it that you mentioned composition. I want to know, where do you think you developed that sensibility? Was it purely filmic inspiration? I guess you said you get inspiration from everywhere, including music, but is there any element of like fine art that you can recall that influenced you?
No, I can't. I don't think there is anything in particular I can kind of focus on. I think, you know, I'm a massive fan of Kubrick. So a lot of my work is very, you know, there's symmetry. There is, I tend not to, I encourage directors not to cut away from scenes. I prefer shots to develop, so that, you know, a scene doesn't become a very cutty scene. I prefer shots which kind of encompass a scene and as much as possible. So I don't think there is anything I focus on. You know, the maybe the simplest thing, you know, of a TV show where a certain framing, you know, where it's short siding or there's something unique about it, and I hold on to it and I write it down in a notebook, and I try and describe to myself what that shot is, so that I can know in a few days, a few months, a few years later, I can be looking through my notebook and I reintroduce myself to this type of framing. You know, I think I take inspiration from all sorts, I think. And it isn't just fine art, you know, it can be, but no, it could be a soap opera, you know, it could be, you know, it could be anything. And I make a note, okay, that was a really interesting piece of framing. That was a really, that told the story in a really beautiful and really interesting way. And I make a note of that, because at some point it'll, you know, it's a little tool I have in my toolbox, so that I can, you know, apply to my own jobs. Yeah. I mean, I take inspiration from all everywhere, but I think Kubrick is probably my number one, but you know, it's anything which kind of takes my eye.
Mm. Is that a part of your brain that is constantly turned on? Are you like viewing the world and all other forms of art or even content of any kind from the lens of how can this suit me? Is that something that you're even aware that you're doing?
I don't know. I mean, I don't think I am aware. My wife would probably tell you something very different. I think whenever we sit down and watch a movie, whatever, sure. I'm one of yeah. those people who just says, oh, well, this, you know, that shot means that, or that shot, you know, isn't there just because it's part, you know, every shot is in the scene for a reason, and I point that out, and much to my wife's annoyance. But yeah, so it is very difficult for me to sometimes to turn off and kind of and look at a film objectively. But saying that, when it does, when I do see something objectively, or when I am entirely sucked into it, I hold on to it. I am and I feel very pleased because the storyteller, the art, you know, the director or whoever behind that show has enabled me to forget about me as a filmmaker, and I've been drawn into the story, and that's when I get excited, is when then I no longer see the photography, I no longer see the direction, I no longer see the design, that, and when I pull into the story, that's when I get excited. They know when I'm thinking about that scene 2 weeks later, that film 2 weeks later, that's when I know that they've done a great job.
Yeah, I've heard that from a lot of like people in the film industry of all different occupations, whether it be sound design or cinematography or, you know, the gaffer or whatever. They tend to think that their most successful moments are when they're rendered invisible and subject to the story. But that being said, with you understanding all the ins and outs and technicalities of the film industry, does that enrich or diminish your appreciation of the art in general, do you think?
I think it depends, really. I think, you know, I need to be very careful what I say here because I don't want to tie myself up in knots. But yeah, I mean, I am very aware of how filmmaking is, how filmmaking works. So if I see a very flashy show, you know, if it's lots of one shots, or if it's, you know, very, very visually striking, it is somewhat taken away from me. And I think, and I also, the reason why I had to be careful is because Handmaid's Tale is very striking. So it's, for me, it's a very fine balance of telling the story in an interesting and a way which pushes the story forward. But it's also very visually interesting as well. And for me, Handmaid's Tale is very difficult, because it has got a very strong visual style, but at no point do I want to take it away from the story. So much so, I often have to stop myself. You know, I could light something, you know, with beams and, you know, smoke and make it look extraordinary every day of the week. But if it is not serving the story properly, then I have to stop. That is what is primary importance. You know, I am way down the list of importance of what is important on a film set. What is most important is the story and what you're trying to tell. The filmmaking process isn't about me. It's about photographing performances. And at no point do I want the entire circus to revolve around me. You know, that's why I'm not a big fan of big camera moves or whatever. You know, I don't want the technical side to get in the way, to fog what I'm trying to tell. I have a basic understanding of what these bits of equipment do, but I only use them sparingly, and only when I know that they will push the story. But I don't want to be that DP who knows about megabits per second and all that other kind of stuff, because that's not what storytelling is about. What storytelling about is as I said, you know, is composition. It's about capturing performances. I think that's what's important as a DP.
So do you work with a lot of storyboards in when you're working on your projects? Do you come up with a lot of it in the moment on when you get to a set, or does that kind of change depending on the director and the relationship with the production?
Yeah, it changes. On Handmaid's Tale, it's we do storyboard, but it does very much depend on the director. Me personally, I don't mind storyboarding. Particularly if it's something quite complicated, you know, whether it's stunts or, you know, there's lots of visual effects or whatever, I think that's kind of important. But I am of a school which enjoys being in the moment. And I think they're good tool in that they kind of give you kind of a broad idea of kind of what you're after. But once the moment you're on set and you see a performance, And you see a tiny little glimpse, you see a tiny little eye flicker, or, you know, just a look away or whatever, that's what's exciting. And you would never, ever get that if you were storyboarding or shotlisting. You'd only ever see it if you were rehearsing or if you were shooting. And so that's what's exciting. So yes, I do storyboard, but they have their limitations. And I don't enjoy sitting in a room telling someone else to draw a mid shot, because that's not particularly helpful. What I enjoy more is is being more fluid and watching scenes develop in front of you. You know, it's very exciting when you are blocking a scene and you do a crew show, and I'm always there anyway. But when you watch performers and you see something, and it's like the most wonderful feeling where you go, that's it, that's the shot we need to tell this story. That's what really excites me, and you'd never get that while sitting in an office in, you know, some, you know, some God knows studio somewhere. You know, it's just being in the moment, and I think that's much more exciting as a filmmaker than storyboarding. I think
absolutely. I mean, I think that's really interesting, bringing back the whole music parallel again. That's so much more of a musical way of thinking than it is like a painterly way of thinking. I think a lot of people, when they look at film, they're just like, oh, every frame of painting and things like that. But it really does feel a part of a much larger brain, that it does feel more like music. Like there's the performers capturing this certain part of the composition, and then the composer, and then the conductor, and, you know, this makes this, and this all generates this whole thing. You have to be in the moment to react. And I think that's kind of interesting for people to think about too. It's not just, I mean, sometimes it is, I guess. Sometimes it is just storyboards, depending on the director, and you just do that. But I think there is a musicality that a lot of people don't realize, because, again, being on a production can sometimes be so stressful that I think people imagine it's thoroughly planned. But there's a lot more spontaneity than people realize sometimes.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's where the gems are. That's when you see something. And so sometimes if you get too kind of focused on the storyboards, you miss something. As I said, you know, storyboards are important, but you see something, or maybe it's not just the performers, maybe it's the designer has made something which you kind of think, oh my God, that I need to photograph that. That's important. That's the key for me. I think that it's being able to move quickly and being able to, you know, these performances are often fleeting. You may get it in take two, and you don't get it any other time. So you need to be quick. You need to know that it's coming. And I think if you become too rigid with storyboards or with bits of equipment which get in the way, then you've missed that opportunity. And that is heartbreaking. You know, I have been there where you want to catch something, but for whatever reason, it's gone. And once it's gone, it's gone. And so we need to be quick as filmmakers to get that. You know, to get that performance, to get that sunrise, and the moment anything gets in the way, then we're doing a bad job, I think.
Yeah, interesting. I mean, that seems to be too, from everybody I've talked to and in my own experience, that being in that moment is the only way you can really, and this is going to sound pretentious, it's not meant to, but it's how you access more of the poetic side of filmmaking versus, you know, whatever, this rigid thing. That's the only way to access it, it feels like, just by like, oh, that's interesting, now do it, and then it ends up changing the feel of it completely.
Absolutely. I don't think it's pretentious at all. I mean, I think that is the fundamentals of what we do. You know, we are there to capture performances. And if for whatever reason that means that I shoot it on a, you know, a documentary camera, I shoot it on my iPhone rather than the big fancy IMAX cameras, that doesn't matter to me. You know, it's just being able to capture those performances, being able to tell a story, that is of utmost importance to me. And then nothing should get in the way of that.
Absolutely. So let's, now that we've, you know, we've gone this far deep into the craft and the artistry of cinematography, tell me how you got here. How did you become a cinematographer? Why did you fall in love with this medium?
So I was very... So I kind of grew up in a small little village in South England, and our school was in a very kind of a tiny little, very picturesque village, you know, thatched cottages. It was you know, kind of picture perfect, really. And one day, I guess I must have been, I don't know, 7 or 8, we got hauled out of our classroom because they were filming a TV show in the local village. And there was something called Miss Marple, which is essentially it's a period drama. It's a detective show on BBC. It was quite a big thing at the time. And I just remember, standing outside there. I mean, I couldn't have been very old. I mean, God knows how old I was, 7 or 8 maybe. And I just remember seeing this guy on the end of a on the end of a crane. It was in the days when, you know, ride on cranes were the thing, rather than nowadays it's all remote heads. But is it? No, there's a guy sitting on the end of a crane, and I just thought, that looks like a pretty cool job. He was being swung across the road and all sorts. And it looked hilarious. It looked great fun. And I just thought, okay, that is the sort of job I'd like to do. And yeah, I was very lucky in that my dad, you know, he was also kind of a very keen amateur photographer. And you know, so we had an old Betamax, well, at the time it was, you know, very very top of the range, but it was a Betamax camera where we used to make our own little crazy short films by stringing a piece of fishing wire across the room and put our little toy Death Star and whiz it across the room to make our own opening sequence of Star Wars. So we just kind of, when I was a kid, we just kind of dicked around with my dad's camera until one day I thought, you know what, I quite like to do this for the rest of my life, really. So that was kind of it. It was just a bit of a passion, you know, which I remember when I was a kid, I just saw people doing it. And I remember also another thing, I was watching something scary. I was watching maybe Doctor Who again when I was a kid. And I was getting quite scared, you know, scary show when you're 8 years old. And my mum and my dad's saying, okay, don't worry, Stuart, you know, it's just remember there's a whole people behind making this show. So right now what you're seeing, although you're seeing a very scary, very kind of, you know, a Dalek who's terrorizing all these people, behind the camera, there's probably 20, 30, 40, 50 people. And no, that was their kind of their way of telling me, Stuart, it's not real. It's all kind of make-believe. And I thought, oh, wow, okay. So there's people doing make-believe on as adults. That sounds like quite good fun. So I thought, okay, let's try and do that. And yeah, here I am.
Interesting. So it's like you being privy to the kind of the magic behind the scenes early on that made you realize that was an actual route that a person could take almost. Versus falling in love with a specific film or the look of a certain thing, you saw people doing it. That's interesting.
That's a good point. I think I probably did. Yes, I think I saw people working. I saw people having a good time. I saw that collaboration, and I thought, yeah, that sounds great. And I guess it probably then clicked. So then one day when I was watching 2001, you know, when I was in my teens, and obviously it blew me away, and I thought, okay, yeah, you know, this pipe dream of mine of working in the industry, you know, I could produce something like this. Not that I ever could, because he's an absolute genius, but I thought, okay, well, you know, once I see that and that's what I could do as a living, that kind of really excited me. And yeah, I was watching Kubrick or, you know, any other kind of extraordinary TV show, you know, and films from, you know, watching Top Gun and thinking, my God, that looks cool. That looks amazing. Kind of really being pulled into it. I thought, yeah, okay. Yeah, that sounds good. Right. Yeah, let's do that, Stuart. Let's do that.
Cool. I mean, well, then why director of photography and cinematography versus director or writer or actor or any other part of the filmmaking process? Why did you land there? Did you go somewhere else first and find yourself there? Or what happened there?
No, I mean, I think another reason why I always wanted to be behind the camera and kind of operating it is because I also wanted to travel. One of the things I wanted to also be was a pilot as well. And I kind of thought, okay, well, you know, so maybe I'm going to be a pilot, maybe I'm going to be a cameraman, I don't know. But then I kind of thought, well, okay, well, being a cameraman means I wanted to travel. You know, that's part of the reason why I wanted to be a pilot. And I thought, well, I could be a cameraman and I can also travel. You know, I used to watch wildlife documentaries and see these people going to these extraordinary places and photographing these extraordinary moments in the environment. I thought, okay, well, that's interesting. To answer your question about whether, you know, why did I want to be a photographer rather than a director? I don't know. I mean, I think it's probably because of my dad. I think, you know, he was a very keen, as I said, very keen photographer. You know, we used to shoot stuff on Super 8. We used to, as I said, shoot stuff on Betamax. And I kind of enjoyed it. I kind of enjoyed the slight kind of technicalities of it and being able to tell the story using a kind of a piece of equipment. rather than, you know, a bit, it's almost something you could actually hold, you know, okay, this is a camera which I can, which I can use to capture this moment, rather than being kind of, as an abstract, being a director, you know, I had to kind of come up with ideas, come abstract ideas and visualize them and then putting them into a scene. You know, I think how holding a camera means I could do it. You know, I could actually do it. I could do with my brothers, I could actually make a short film. And I think that's what kind of interested me, I think. I'm probably not making myself very clear, but I think that's probably the way I thought.
You like the tactility of it?
Yes, exactly. The tactility of it. That's exactly right.
Very cool. That's interesting. So did you start out as a more of a camera operator then? And do you still operate on the pieces you work on?
I do, yeah. I mean, I started out as an operator and I love it. Being close to a performer is incredibly exhilarating. Being that physical, you can adjust the frame. That being so close to that, the actual making the process is very exciting. And also, is you get to speak to the actors, and for me that's very interesting as well. Being behind a monitor, I do, because you know sometimes that's what the role requires, but I don't find that quite as fulfilling. I do love to operate. I started out as an operator, not really so much in drama. I used to be a multi-camera operator on things like in the UK, things like on Blind Date, Have I Got News for You, on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. So it's kind of a big kind of light entertainment, multi-camera stuff. And I enjoyed it, but it wasn't really that fulfilling for me. And I remember one day holding a mid-shot on some game show somewhere. And I just thought, okay, I think I was in my 20s. And I thought, okay, I don't want to do this anymore. This is not fulfilling. You know, I've kind of got where I could probably go. I got there quite quickly and I thought, okay, I don't want to do this anymore. And at that point I thought, you know what, I'm going to go back to film school. I kind of gave it all up and left a fairly well-paid freelance job to go back to film school, where I learned how to light. I learned how to be a cinematographer to a lesser or greater degree. But yeah, I love operating. You know, it's a very, having the tactile of being able to physically change a frame according to the performance is very exciting.
So you were already well into the industry when you decided to go back to school?
Yeah, I was. Yeah. So I went to a place called the National Film Television School, which is quite it's a big film school in the UK. And what they do, I think they still do, is that they do encourage people to come to this school who've already had been in the industry before, who perhaps want to make that step up. And that's what the film school does. You know, I had already been to university. I'd already been working, as I said, as a cameraman. And then I knew this wasn't for me. I knew I had to go back to school. And that's what they do. It is an incredible place. I was very lucky to, my cinematography course was only 5 students. And my tutor was a cinematographer called Brian Tofano, who'd shot Trainspotting. He shot Shelley Gray, some extraordinary films back in the 90s. And he was our tutor. And here he was talking to five kids, basically, with our eyes open, our mouths open, this guy telling us, you know, his experiences on a film set. It's an incredible place. You know, we had Billy Williams teaching us. You know, he shot Gandhi. He won an Oscar for Gandhi. We had Roger Deakins came in and he kind of gave a masterclass as well.
Yeah,
it is this extraordinary place. And when you've got that kind of intimacy and that kind of intense information coming down on you, you feel very lucky. And you know, I loved it. And if I had not been to the film school, I wouldn't be here now for sure.
Well, aside from your love of Kubrick, was there any other directors, filmmakers, or cinematographers specifically that made you your brain light up and go, oh, this is interesting. I'm learning. I'm inspired by this. Was there any specific moment, whether it be at school or as a kid, aside from seeing Miss Marple and 2001 that really got you jazzed on the whole thing?
I mean, typical as a kid, it was Star Wars. It was anything by Spielberg. It was, you know, watching Back to the Future 100 times when it came out on VHS, watching Jurassic Park when it came out on VHS. You know, it was it was all the kind of those kind of real big blockbuster movies, which I kind of fell in love with and which I still adore today. So, yeah, I mean, it wasn't just, you know, it wasn't just big movies. It was, even now, it's something called Red Riding, which was a show kind of back in the 2000s, which, again, really piqued my interest in TV as well. You know, I think right now we're in a bit of a golden age of TV. I remember thinking at the time that, for me, that was a really interesting show in that it really kicked off, for me at least, that my experience of film can be brought to the small screen. And, you know, you see it every day now. You see how good this kind of TV shows now, that they are comparable to films. You know, we shoot in the same way as films. But for me, that was one of the first things I ever saw where I thought, okay, you can bring the film, you can bring the big screen to the small screen. When you see that and you're going, okay, this opened up a whole new world to me. So I think Red Riding, you know, I think that was a big thing for me. Spielberg. I mean, anything by Roger Deakins now is, I'm just blown away by. Janusz Kaminski was also, and still is, and he's a big influence on my work. I'm not alone in saying that Roger Deakins is an absolute genius. His work is extraordinary. I think what he does, which interests me, is that his work evolves. You know, everything changes, you know, in his work from one film to the next. You know, you see behind the scenes footage of what he does and it changes. You know, he lights a certain way for a certain film. You know, he doesn't have one particular style. You know, he has many different styles, which I am in awe of, and he lights differently. You know, uses different bits of kit depending on the job. I know that's what I find fascinating. And I think the guy's a genius.
I mean, I think we're all in agreement on that. I mean, it's pretty unanimous that guy's one of the all time best. But the thing that's interesting about him too, like you were just touching on that a little bit, is that the idea of not having a style, but it's like. And I think that's actually a superpower. I think for a long time in any of the art industries, it's been pushed upon you that like you need to have this specific style and that's you and that's you forever. Whereas like someone like Roger Deakins and a lot of the artists that I respect, whether it be directors, cinematographers, musicians, or painters, they adapt their skill set to whatever the project needs. And it's a certain level of quality and taste that becomes who you are, and almost like defining a voice rather than a style, I thought. And I think that's really an amazing thing that he's kind of championed through his work. And I think it's incredibly inspiring. And it should be to like all artists of any medium.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. And I think kind of what I touched on earlier is that he doesn't let the process of making a film get in the way. You know, it is always focused on the story. I remember walking past. I think here, I'm not entirely sure what he was shooting. I think it might have been Spectre, and they were shooting in London. And I remember walking past. I came across it entirely by accident, and I didn't even realize what it was. I thought it was a fairly kind of low key show, until I realized that, you know, it was Roger Deakins shooting, and he was using very simple bits of kit. You know, and that's what I like about him. You know, of course, he gets the big lamps in when he needs to, but he's very simple. He's very straightforward, you know. And I, in my own very small way compared to him, I like to do something similar. In that, I know I like to be intimate. I like to be small, and I don't like to get in the way of the vision of the director. You know, I think, you know, I almost need to be invisible. I think that's super important, and I think Roger Deakins is a master at that.
Yeah, that's terrific. I mean, it's something freeing about being totally liberated from dogma and ideology of like bigger is better and more expensive and yada, yada, yada. you know, you can, these ideas can be left over from the idea of like, oh, you need to overlight something because it's on a sound state, you know, it's on a set, or versus out in real life where the sun can be the best use of light or whatever, you know, that adapting process, again, being in the moment is really what it's about versus bringing your baggage to the project. But all of that being said, so you specifically as an artist in your craft as a cinematographer, what is something, a project that you have been especially proud of for whatever reason, and why is that?
I think right now, and I think maybe it's because it's one of my most recent jobs, but I am so pleased with what I did on Handmaid's Tale. I am over the moon with how it looked, and how I was able to tell that story. Perhaps I am being, you know, because my mind is drawn to it because it is the most recent thing. But kind of thinking back at what I've done in the past, it's documentaries I've worked on. You know, at film school, I did a documentary about Eugène Auger, who's a French photographer. And it was one of the most fulfilling experiences I've ever had. It was we spent about 2 months in Paris. We went to find these locations which Eugène had photographed, and we went back to photograph them again. And he kind of we almost became him. You know, we wandered around Paris with our camera, trying to find these locations. We walked for hours and hours, trying to find out where these, you know, we find little signs of whereabouts we think that he may have photographed them. And for me, that was exciting. I loved it. It was, you know, it was very much, it was me, a sound recordist and a director. And we were so invested in it. And that what you see is part of us, you know, it is us, it's the three of us creating this. You know, we shot it in film school, but it's a really beautiful piece. And looking back at it now, it's also probably one of my best pieces of work, because it is part of me is on screen. You know, I can't go on about it enough, but I loved it. It was so much fun. And then, as I said, being allowed to put something on screen, which is part of you, is incredible privilege. And we certainly did it on that. And I'm always striving for that. And even now, you know, it happened on Handmaid's Tale, and I hope it happens again on other shows. I really do. But being allowed to put something of your heart on screen, or on the big screen or whatever, is incredibly exciting. And they don't happen on every job. They really don't. You know, you probably one in every 10 jobs it happens. But once it does happen, it is the most exciting thing you could ever experience.
Yeah, amazing. It sounds like almost like adventurous, like you're longing to be a pilot, and then the cameraman thing seems like there's some kind of sense of adventure in what you want to get out of life, which is great. I think you can see it in the work as well. You predominantly work in TV now. Is that a concerted effort, or is that just something that you kind of fell into, or what's the story there?
I think I kind of fell into working in TV, to be honest. And that was me, to be honest, it was probably out of necessity, I think, at the time. I just left film school. I wanted to shoot movies, but at the time I had rent to pay, I had bills to pay. So I took a job shooting a soap opera. And then kind of from there, it's kind of snowballed, really. And so I kind of, it's difficult. I think maybe not so much now, but I think certainly at that time, they're two very different avenues. You know, you either do features or you do TV. And at the time, I kind of fell into doing TV. I don't regret it one bit. I absolutely do not. And right now, given how good the TV industry is, I'm glad I made that route. But also, I learned so much. I learned so much doing soap opera, doing a couple of soap operas. You learn how to tell a story in the most efficient way, because you can only shoot a scene in, you know, 5 minutes. Sometimes, you know, everyone's looking at their watches and going, okay, well, how are we going to tell this story, this scene in 5 minutes? So you very quickly learn how to tell a story in its most component parts. And that's what I learned. You learn how to photograph quickly. You learn how to light quickly. And then slowly you kind of work your way up into bigger and better things. Not necessarily better things, but bigger things, certainly, you know, slower things in a way. And but all those kind of lessons I learned from working my way up, I still use now. You know, I remember learning something shooting these dramas. And even today, I still there's a certain technique I use which I learned from when I was doing these low budget soap operas. I don't regret anything I've ever done. I learn everything every day. And you know, when you're starting out, you learn a lot in those kind of situations. I'm glad to be doing TV now. I feel very lucky to be in this vein right now. Long may it continue.
Do you have any interest in working on features as well, or is the TV thing fulfilling enough and you just like going towards that?
I'd love to shoot a film. although I say all that and I say that I'm very happy to be in the TV industry, but my God, I'd love to shoot a film. I haven't shot a film now for probably about 5 or 6 years. But yeah, my God, I'd love to. Just being something in its creation, in its very, first days of creation, and then seeing something to the very end, I'd love to be involved in. Things are always on the horizon for me. I always have scripts put my way, and I think for me sometimes films are a little bit more risky. Sometimes they happen, sometimes they don't. Whereas TV right now is, once you're on board, you're almost certain to be there till the very end. But I think films, not so much. But yeah, I want to shoot a film. Yeah, someone send me a nice film script. I'm dying to shoot a film. So send them in. I can't wait. So yeah, absolutely, I want to shoot a film.
What's the criteria for picking your projects then? Is it the script, the concept, the director? Is it all of the above? Like what gets you excited to take up projects?
All of the above. It is primary is the story. That is, I feel as though I'm banging on about it. I'm like a broken record going about the story. But it is that has to fulfill that has to be, the one thing I'm drawn to. Because if I'm not, then I can't do a very good job. If I can't connect to a script in one way or another, I'm not going to be able to do a good enough job. Working with the director is getting on with the director is also vitally important. We are, as I'm sure your listeners know and understand, it's very intense. It's when we're working on set, we are with these people for 12 plus hours a day, and I don't want to be working with, frankly, assholes. I want to be working with nice people. So I do. I choose a job depending on the director. I want to have a nice time. I don't want to come home pulling my hair out because I've had a terrible time. It's a very collaborative industry, and if for whatever reason I don't have that collaboration, it's particularly unpleasant. It's the script and the director. That for me is the most important thing for me. And right now I'm in a lucky position that I can kind of pick and choose. But yeah, they are so important for me. And if one of them isn't on the right path, then I will pass on it.
So when you get a story that you connect with, do you immediately see the image in your mind about how you would shoot it, how it would feel, or is that just, do you connect with it on a more visceral level and just feel like, oh, I need to be a part of this in some capacity?
Yeah, I think it's kind of, I try not to have too many kind of preconceived ideas about how I will shoot this or how I will light this. What I do when I'm given a script is I try as much as I can to read it as a member of the audience, and I try to feel it's very center, what it is, what the story is. Because the moment I start coming up with ideas about how I'm going to shoot it, the director will come along and go, that's lovely, but I was thinking more like this. So I try not to. I do my best. Of course, it's very, you know, it's impossible not to think about when something is so, when you read something and it's so, you know, evokes so many emotions, then of course you are going to kind of, you are think about certain scenes and how you might light it or certain references you have. But the first time I read it, I try not to. I try to read it like I am reading as a first timer. You know, I do think that's very important. And I think also you need to do that every so often as well. I read the scripts countless times, you know, hundreds of times throughout the process. You read it again and again and again, and you kind of, but it mainly kind of on a technical level, but sometimes you do have to kind of go back and kind of, okay, well, what is this story about? What is this, the very core of the story? And I think that's very important to every so often just stop and to read a script as if it was the first time. So that you kind of reacquaint yourself as to what the scenes are trying to tell us. So yeah, I try not to have too many preconceived ideas as much as very difficult as it is. But yeah, I try not to.
Do you ever fight with the director for if you just know that this is the best possible shot and you see the sun going down, you're like, oh, we're gonna lose it. Do you ever fight for that shot, or do you have to just submit to the hierarchy of the set?
You do to some extent. I mean, I never fight with the director because I don't like fighting with anyone. It's very unpleasant for everyone, not just me and the director, but also for the crew around you. Sure. So I do try to persuade. I think that's what I generally try to do. I say, your ideas are great, but can I maybe suggest this as well? If the director says no, I can't, you know, it's wrong for me to go, fuck you, I'm going to shoot it anyway, because that's not what I do. But also, I would hope that I never get in that. I would hope that I never get in that position anyway, because you would hope by a certain point in pre-production, you're very much on the same level anyway. You've got a similar kind of ideas, you have the same thoughts, and you have the same kind of language. So no, I tend not to argue, and if there is a disagreement, then usually it's pretty amicable, and usually we end up just shooting both. You kind of go, okay, here's your version, and then I may put in my version as maybe B camera at the same time, and we kind of cover both worlds, and then they can kind of choose in the edit, But I don't hold grudges. You know, if they don't use my idea, then that's okay. That's fine. It's, you know, life's too short to be holding a grudge.
Well, I love that humility and diplomacy. That's a great tactic, I feel like. Well, I think this has been a great discussion. And I think that usually we wrap these up with, if you had any advice to young creatives or someone starting out, whether it be the field of cinematography or creativity in general, do you have any advice or words of wisdom that you'd like to say to the young people out there?
I think if one thing I would say, if you want to be a filmmaker, if you want to be a cinematographer, shoot as much as you can. It doesn't matter what it is. Certainly when you're starting off, don't feel as though shooting a low budget, you know, TV show is a bad thing. It is a good thing. And to shoot as much as you can, shoot short films, shoot music videos, get your friends together, shoot on a mobile phone. Now that we're in a stage in the kind of the filmmaking of the process of filmmaking now that you can shoot on a mobile phone. You don't need to have an Alexa or a 35mm camera. Now you can shoot with this most smallest amount of equipment. So get friends together and, you know, make movies. You know, it is incredibly easy now to make films now. You know, you just need to go into Vimeo or all sorts of online platforms and you just see some extraordinary stuff. And I don't know how they do it because it looks incredible. And, you know, it's people with the smallest amount of kit, but there's some really good storytelling there. And, If you're able to do that, then you're off to a bit of a winner. But yeah, just shoot as much as you can.
Amazing. Thank you, Stuart. I really appreciate that. Thank you so much for your time today.
Absolute pleasure. It's good to talk to you. And thank you so much.
Music for the podcast is by Rarebit, aka Justin Dosher Hopkins. Creative producer is Noah Wainwright. YouTube and creative support is by Tyler Scully. Thanks so much for tuning in. See you next time.